My name is Lester Thompson, and I'd like to give you a brief overview of ImmunoQuery. ImmunoQuery is an interactive platform to be used by pathologists in evaluating immunohistochemistry findings and sort of to gain a better understanding of immunohistochemistry support function. It can be used obviously in real time based on evidence in the literature to make a decision about not only how to select immunohistochemistry studies, but also how to interpret the results after receiving the studies back. Dr. Dennis Frisman developed this particular service way back in the 1990s while working at the Armed Forces Institute of Pathology in Washington, D.C. He was the chief of the immunohistochemistry lab and as a result would get all of the consultation cases back with the immunohistochemistry results filled in and created a platform of IHC results that was seen in each of these specific tumor settings. He then added supporting literature from the major pathology journals for these results and displayed them all via a relational database. It has certainly come a long way since then, but that legacy data still remains today and is obviously added to quite frequently. So you will notice that within the ImmunoQuery component, there are several different functions. Obviously, we're in the build panel approach at this particular time, but the learning function can also be used. You can save cases that you can look at a later time, and of course, you can build a panel for various diagnostic interpretations. So in this particular case, let's just build something for a differential. As you type, you will notice that it is progressive, and that means as you're typing out the words, the various factors will come into play. And in this particular case, I was hoping to use meningioma as one of them. The second alternative I was going to use was synovial sarcoma. This is a very unusual sort of nested and spindle cell tumor of the sinonasal tract area, and there were several areas that kind of had either synovial sarcoma or meningioma type patterns of growth. But then there were also areas that had kind of a more undifferentiated carcinoma or undifferentiated sarcoma appearance to them. And so if you type out something like that undifferentiated, certainly you're going to get a whole bunch of different findings. But if you bring up undifferentiated here and begin to scroll down, you should be able to find your particular result. And here you can see sarcoma NOS and malignant fibrous histiocytoma as the older terminology. Then when you get over to this particular side, you will notice that build panel is now available to you, and you just click on that particular function. And it will take just a couple of seconds, and lo and behold, you will soon have all of your results shown. Now, it's kind of divided out into a sort of suggested panel versus a comprehensive panel. If you click on the suggested panel, it'll actually bring it down to a very small group of immunohistochemistry findings that may be of value in this particular setting. And you will notice in this case, CA19-9 is present in 100% of cases of meningioma while absent in the other two lesions of consideration. So if I were thinking about these particular diagnoses as a group, I certainly would be able to separate it now with at least one of those particular studies, with CD271 being present in synovial sarcoma while not really positive in meningioma. Now, I will say with these particular findings, you will notice they do tend to maximize both sensitivity and specificity in this particular case, but it also may be that you just don't have these particular antibodies available in your panel. And so if you go back to the comprehensive panel here, you will notice that the first few listings in this particular group really are trying to highlight ones that may be able to differentiate, hence the positive green arrow showing here, versus those that do not help you at all, and then those that are neutral. So in this particular case, you can see that CA19-9 is quite helpful with meningioma and may be able to help you with that consideration, even in separating it from malignant fibrous histiocytoma, and yet the red axes here indicate that it would not help you separating between synovial sarcoma and a sarcoma NOS. So then this is where you're able to actually begin to scroll through these particular antibodies and look for ones that you may have available in your particular lab. So as an example, we've already thought, well, you know, the CA19-9 being present in so many of the meningiomas is certainly going to be a helpful function. But as I scroll down, I can see that TLE1 here is also helpful helpful and present in 91% of synovial sarcomas, while it's not really present in very many undifferentiated sarcomas or malignant fibrous histiocytoma. So potentially that would be another marker that you would be able to use. And I will say for this particular differential, you can really tell that there are dozens and dozens of different antibodies that have been included in this for consideration. Once you get down to about 50% of the way, then you will notice that these really are not going to help you very much, either because they're positive to a certain degree in each of the tumors present, or that they're just not positive in a sufficient number of cases in order to be of value. So at this particular point, let's go all the way back up here to some of the other antibodies, and you will notice in this particular case there are references being listed for TLE1. You will see that there are 91% of cases and 277 have actually been tested. And so in this particular case, if you click on the reference function at that particular time, you will notice it has now brought up all of the references that may be potentially valuable in this particular case. And here you can see that when you hover over it, it actually highlights that particular finding. And in this case, you would then be able to go and click on this particular reference. It would take you directly into PubMed and allow you to be able to go and look at that particular source in order to be able to confirm the findings of that particular result. So I think that this is one way to sort of trust but verify, where you are allowed to actually go and look at the supporting literature and be able to use that in your findings in that particular case. So the number of cases that are present, the number that have been tested, and which particular marker may or may not be of assistance in it is quite helpful. Now, you'll also notice these particular sensitivities and minimum references. I happen to have this set at having at least one reference on the topic. You can change that clearly and have it be, you know, much more specific, where you have now more than five references, or you can click it where it would have all of the references that are available on the topic, and the same thing with the degree of sensitivity and specificity in this particular case. So if you would like to save this for a later time, you can just click on the save for analysis. It'll take just a couple of seconds and allow you to be able to say, hey, this is what I've just put in here, and you'll notice it has automatically saved it for me, so that I can always come back to this at a later time in order to be able to review it later on. So instead of doing a diagnosis panel in this particular case, why don't we do it based on antibodies? So in this particular case, let's put in SOX10 just as one of the ones that I would like to include in this particular case. And why don't we add in mammoglobin? And you'll notice again, as I'm typing, it progressively fills in so that you'll know which one is present. And let's put in P63 as well. And you'll notice that here comes the P63 result. Now, this is limited to only three different search criteria. As you can imagine, it becomes exponentially more difficult to be able to separate out between things as you add successive numbers of antibodies to be able to separate between them. So let's go to build a panel in this particular case. And in this setting, you're actually going to have the diagnoses that may or may not express these particular markers in some degree or another, that allow you to be able to look at, okay, if this is a panel that I'm going to be using, what is it that may help me in trying to come up with an accurate diagnosis in this particular case. And so you will see that, pleomorphic adenoma is in this particular case, but there are only 6% of cases that have mammoglobin positive. Obviously, normal breast tissue is present. And as you go through, you will notice that the display of each of these particular radio buttons is now filled in to say that a positive result is going to be meaningful in this particular diagnosis, where if it has a very small amount of green present in it, it may not be very useful. And then, of course, when it's filled in with a grayed out area, it's saying, well, this is not really going to separate between each of these particular categories for you in any sort of meaningful fashion. And so here, if you're looking at something like an infiltrating ductal carcinoma, these particular markers are not going to be of value for you if you're looking at that particular finding. So this is something where perhaps you had five or six immunohistochemistry studies that you performed and got the results back and are like, wow, you know, I'm not quite sure what that's supposed to mean. Is there something that I'm I'm missing, or is there something that I should have thought about instead? Again, references are available for you. You can click on the references and it's going to pull up the references for you and allow you to go and look at that particular reference. Again, just clicking on the link and taking you to whatever is present in PubMed for that particular topic as well. So a useful function and something definitely that can be quite helpful in that particular setting. So one of the other things that you may want to be able to utilize is the learn function. So the learn function allows you to be able to say, listen, what is it if I want to actually, let's say, learn a little bit more here. I just tested these three antibodies. Let me learn a little bit more about SOX10. And so when you push that particular function, it now brings up the category. It tells you who all the major manufacturers are, what all the various clones are, so that you know exactly in your lab with what it is that you're getting a result for, how you would be able to interpret those particular results. And so these are the most common clones that are out there. And then as you scroll down, you will notice here are all of the various topics that are present in this particular case. And so you can actually scroll through. Truly, in this particular case with SOX10, there have been thousands of different things that have been identified as potential markers, either positively or negatively. And again, as you scroll through, there's going to be a lot of literature in this particular case because it is such a large volume of material that is being incorporated into, you know, what type of tests could be used, how are they meaningful, is it something that you can actually utilize in your own group. And of course, you know, again, because it is active, you would be able to click on it and it would take you to the marker. You know, in this particular case, I happen to be highlighting the manuscript from Markku Mietinen just because I happen to know that it had more than 5,000 different tumors evaluated in it for SOX10. And so again, that can be something that is super useful and super helpful. And again, of course, if you want to go and look at the article, you just click on whatever your PubMed reference is and you can download a PDF of the article. And here you have it and can actually go and look through the article yourself, read all of the material that is present in it, and then of course look at each of the findings and where they stained and how they marked, in addition to looking at the original tables of information that would be able to help you with your particular tumor, if that is what you wanted to look at that particular time. So the final function that I would like to just briefly show here is the CME. So as you can tell, if you click on the CME button, it will take you to the CME page, and here are all of the various topics that you have learned about. So here is building of this particular antibody panel, and I'm going to say I'm going to claim credit for this particular topic. It's going to ask what is it that you wanted to do, and maybe I'll say build an antibody panel for salivary gland tumors, and type that in while we're doing this. Say that I was going to use it for diagnosis, and it modified your plan. You submit for credit. It immediately generates a certificate, and then you can print the certificate out in 2 seconds and be able to actually look at it and save it and send it to whoever it is that keeps track of your category one credits. So again, a very nice function with being able to have CME available to you in that particular setting. Likewise, you are able to actually link directly through here to Expert Path. So if you click on this particular function, it'll take you to Expert Path, which is kind of the sister organization or the sister function for this, which I will cover in a separate video.